Radovan Karadzic planned some of the worst atrocities of the Bosnian War. Now he'll spend the rest of his life in jail. He appealed against a 40-year jail sentence, but instead a UN court has increased it. But do the families of those who were slaughtered in Srebrenica feel justice has been served? This is Inside Story. Hello and welcome to the programme. I'm Nick Clark. When Yugoslavia broke up in the early 1990s, it triggered a three-year conflict that led to the worst atrocities in Europe since World War II. The leader of the Bosnian Serbs back then was Radovan Karadzic. He planned the 1995 Srebrenica massacre, where almost 8,000 men and boys were killed in a campaign of genocide against Bosnian Muslims. Well, on Wednesday, the 73-year-old lost his appeal against a 40-year sentence. The UN court in The Hague increased that to life behind bars. Survivors of the massacre celebrated, but many Bosnian Serbs still regard Karadzic as a hero. Sonia Giego reports now from The Hague.
The faces of the dead of the Srebrenica massacre, remembered by their loved ones, victims of the genocide perpetrated by Bosnian Serb leader Radovan Karadzic. It has taken nearly 25 years for justice to be realized, a painful journey often bereft of hope. But the wait has finally come to an end. Karadzic listened intently as the court listed his grounds for appeal and rejected them almost entirely.
The prosecution's appeal in all other respects sets aside judges De Prada and Rosa dissenting the sentence of 40 years of imprisonment and imposes judge De Prada and Rosa dissenting a sentence of life imprisonment.
Outside the tribunal, it was a decision welcomed by all who had gathered there, but the suffering is never far away.
I am satisfied, but I want to ask Karadzic, which school did he go to learn how to kill our children, our sons, our husbands? I am satisfied, but then again I am not, because I no longer have my children.
In Srebrenica itself, tears of relief fell when the tribunal announced it would increase Karadzic's sentence.
This is one of the last remaining rulings dealing with the brutal breakup of Yugoslavia. And the sentencing of Radovan Karadzic is also being seen as a crucial test, holding de facto leaders to account for crimes committed during conflicts.
The case has been one of the most high-profile legal battles of the Yugoslav wars. More than 8,000 Muslim men and boys were slaughtered in the Srebrenica massacre. It was the worst genocide to have taken place in Europe since World War II. While the town has become symbolic of the very worst atrocities that took place in the Balkans during the war, it has also been a milestone for the legal consequences that followed.
It took 20 years, and let's hope it's not going to take 20 years for Syria, for Yemen, for all of these other places where similar atrocities are being committed. We as an international community have to be more committed to bring justice to the victims way sooner than 20 years.
Radovan Karadzic will now spend the rest of his days behind bars. His genocidal actions scarred an entire region, and they leave behind a legacy of anguish from which many will never recover. Sonia Gallego, Al Jazeera, The Hague.
All right, let's bring in our guests. Joining us from Raleigh, North Carolina, is Jasmin Mujanovic, a political scientist who researches the Balkans at Elon University. In the Rijeka in Croatia, on Skype, is Refik Hodzic, a journalist who's worked for the International Center for Transitional Justice and the International Criminal Tribunal for Yugoslavia. And in Toronto, we have Emila Butarovic, a professor of humanities and religious studies at York University. Welcome to you all. Good to see you there. We would like to start with Refik Hodzic, because you are from an area that was at the very heart of the atrocities. What does it mean to you to see this life sentence handed down?
I think that one prevailing feeling is of a final end of a stage in which Radovan Karadzic, in fact, shaped our realities for now close to 30 years. He's been a figure who has first committed the crimes and dehumanized, most importantly, an entire population of people in Bosnia, and left a legacy which lingers on today. I think that his verdict, especially the verdict which basically removes him from our midst, effectively now opens the space for a new stage, and that is a stage in which we will hopefully find strength to deal with the legacy of dehumanization and genocide that he leaves behind.
Amilara in Toronto, a new stage is welcomed by all, no doubt, to try and seek out reconciliation. But reconciliation does seem a long way off, doesn't it?
It does. Alas, the legacy of Radovan Karadzic persists, and this is something that we have to address. It is very difficult, of course, to undo history over the past 30 years. But from now on, there must be a way of addressing all those issues that have been left behind. He might be now in prison for a very long time. We don't really know. But those who have supported him and those who have, in fact, built a reality on the ground are still around. And Bosnia is partitioned in that regard as well. So that has to be addressed.
OK, well, let's give this some context. Now, we can look at this, the background to everything. The Bosnian War ended in 1995 with a Dayton Peace Accords. The aim was to ease ethnic tensions, but they created one of the world's most complicated political systems in the process. The country was divided into two entities, the Federation of Bosnia and Herzegovina and Republika Srpska. Bosniaks and Croats form the majority in the Federation, while Republika Srpska is 81% Serb. Instead of one president, Bosnia has three. They represent each ethnicity and share the job. They're elected every 4 years and rotate in the post every 8 months. Now, as well as a national parliament, there are assemblies at the entity and canton levels. Each region has its own parliament and has its own ministers who govern by consensus. Jasmin Mujanovic, it's complicated to say the least, and these ethnic divisions were largely frozen in place by the Dayton Peace Accord, weren't they? And that is very much a problem.
Yes, it is. I mean, it's a structural issue in Bosnia-Herzegovina that this ethnic partition, as Amila was talking about, has created a state where it's very difficult to imagine and in fact, enact any kind of meaningful democratic change, and which also impacts the possibilities for ordinary citizens to engage in meaningful reconciliation efforts. As long as you have the primary political administrative units in the country being essentially solely based on the category of ethnicity, which was also the purpose and indeed the intent of people like it, Radovan Karadzic, to create such a state, to create these Bantustans. As long as that remains the lived reality in Bosnia-Herzegovina, it's extremely difficult to imagine Bosnia becoming a functional, democratic, multi-ethnic and secular state as it should be.
Right, but to deconstruct that system is likely to reignite and further inflame an already difficult situation, isn't it?
I think the reality is for most ordinary Bosnians and Herzegovinians, they have lived with the consequence of Karadzic's project for the better part of the last almost 30 years. They have lived every day the reality of the Dayton Peace Accords. I think there is a widespread, albeit quiet, recognition that meaningful change is long overdue for Bosnia-Herzegovina. Obviously, there's been efforts made, very serious efforts, to allow those changes to take place within the framework of EU and NATO enlargement, and that is an absolutely integral part of the story. But it must be said that sooner or later, Bosnia must undergo a process of constitutional change. Ideally, that is a process that will be grassroots-led, but it will also necessarily involve a significant commitment on the part of the international community to facilitate that that process happens in a peaceful manner for all involved.
Emila, what do you think about that? What do you think about this process of constitutional change? Is that something that's going to be possible to achieve in the coming years?
Yes, I do think that the constitutional change is inevitable. It simply has to happen. And alas, I don't think it can happen only with the players in Bosnia and Herzegovina. It has to happen at the international level. It has to be overseen. It has to be engaged in a way that, in some ways, pays attention to the fact that there is a reality. I mean, some people, children were born and grew up within this reality. They cannot imagine a different Bosnia. And they need to, in fact, come to terms with the history that has actually created it, and they need to move towards a civic society which is not, which does not prioritize identity, which does not prioritize who we are against others, but rather civil society, civil institutions, civil values that have to be taught from scratch, and that have to, in fact, I think, be done with international recognition, supervision, and engagement.
Indeed. And Refik Hodzic, there are absurdities, aren't there? You have schools segregated with students attending the same school, but going at different times, so they avoid each other.
Look, I think that the key issue here is that there has not been, in fact, an effort on part of any group, including Bosnian Muslims and its leadership, to, in fact, undo the legacy of Karadzic's crimes so far. It seems that the elites have been happy to rule in their own fiefdoms, which allows very much for rampant corruption and control of their own resources. If you look at Republika Srpska and places like Prijedor, where I come from, there is no effort to actually undo through constant, systematic effort to help people who have returned gain employment or invest in the integration of the country. And that is one of the key problems. Republika Srpska has never been made by its partners at the state level to acknowledge what has happened and what crimes were committed, or repair its citizens, or Bosnian Muslims and Croats. So, in fact, I think this is why I see this moment as an opportunity to actually change the paradigm completely, not simply to expect that somehow by miracle people will wake up one day and say, oh, yes, genocide was committed.
What does that change look like? What does changing the paradigm look like?
In my opinion, first of all, we have to accept that if we are to insist on constitutional changes today out of the context that exists, it is very unlikely to happen without major, major international pressure. Whether that pressure is realistic to expect or not, I really cannot say. But what can be done, again, are steps in acknowledging the crimes that were done, repairing the victims, repairing the communities which were destroyed, and having that process, in fact, catalyze what Amila is talking about in terms of civil society engagement that can lead to a situation where constitutional change that is required is, in fact, possible.
Well, the look of constitutional change is what I'm after. Jasmin, what's your view of that? How would it shape up? At the moment, we have three presidents. How would we change that?
Well, I mean, again, I think we should be reticent at this stage in particular to not engage in sort of concrete blueprints or spell out concrete blueprints, because that itself becomes a tremendous source of conflict and acrimony in Bosnia-Herzegovina, unfortunately. I think what needs to be emphasized is something that Amila already gestured at, that is that in so much as Bosnia is continuously told to be a state with a European and indeed perhaps even one hopes, I hope, an Atlantic future as well. It is a state that must move towards meaningful, liberal, democratic reform. I think in this way, what it means is that there is and can and should be an accommodation between the rights of individuals and the rights of communities and certain kinds of ethnic rights and certain kinds of ethnic interests, as it were. But you cannot have this kind of sectarian state that we have at present. Bosnia-Herzegovina can and should look to states like South Africa, which have gone through similar experiences of dealing with tremendous trauma, tremendous historical injustices in the past. Even places like Canada, which obviously deal with a multiplicity of communities, crimes, and indeed a cultural genocide that was committed against the indigenous peoples in Canada as well. So there's a multiplicity of examples that are available to us. But what it requires is the first step to get to everything that both Refik and Amila have been talking about, about is a joint commitment, a joint campaign of pressure building, both at the grassroots local level in Bosnia-Herzegovina, and of course a meaningful commitment, a meaningful reaching out on the part of key international states to say that, yes, this is possible, yes, we will accommodate this, and yes, we will support these efforts so that Bosnia can become a vibrant, multi-ethnic, liberal democracy.
Right, and Mile, the Serb member of the presidency, that's Milad Dodik, he has said that the Yugoslav War Crimes Court was designed to build trust among Bosnia's former war foes, but has instead driven them further apart. That seems certainly true.
Yes, I think that we can criticize, of course, the court, and we can criticize the whole procedure and how long it has taken. But I think it's extremely important to acknowledge, on the one hand, its symbolic power, and also its potential to become a platform for change. Symbolically, of course, it sends a message that if you do such things, you will not be treated as a natural disaster. It is not as if some terrible meteor fell on Bosnia and destroyed the communities. It is an act of political, systematic project of genocide, of removal, of dehumanization, as Refik mentions, and so on and so forth. So this way, there is an agency and there is a person and there are people who are held responsible. And therefore, it is a message. It's a symbolic message that such things should be held accountable by international community. It's also, I think, symbolic in the sense that we just saw in New Zealand what has happened. There is inspiration that this has leaked over into international scene, perhaps surreptitiously, but it's out there. We need to come together as an international community that upholds certain values about the human rights, about the value of human life, and proceed from there. So Dodik, at this point, of course, has to find a way of both acknowledging that process had to happen, but also that it is now fault. And this is not unusual. I mean, it is not unusual to see denial that there is any legitimacy in this. But legitimacy has been given an international seal, and I think that is a very powerful statement that international community can now go with and then start the process of change that both Jasmin and Refik talk about and that I think is imminent. It has to happen right away.
Right. It's interesting you brought up the subject of nationalism. I was going to move on to that, this concept of white supremacy. You talked about New Zealand and the suspect in New Zealand's mosque attacks. It seems was inspired by Karadzic and Serbian nationalist heroes. Refik Hodzic, at home and away from the region, Karadzic's extremist ideas still gain a lot of traction, especially in this changing world of leaders who have these nationalistic visions.
I agree. I think that the key concept here is the dehumanization of Muslims that Karadzic has shaped as an ideology which allowed for all these crimes of extermination and genocide to take place. Because don't forget, we had decades of living in the concept of brotherhood and unity. And in order for people to be able to actually engage in this kind of violence against their neighbors had to be dehumanized to the level of vermin that needed to be removed. For that, Karadzic went into history and found examples, many examples of suffering of the Serb people at the hand of the Ottomans or Ustashas in the Second World War, to basically send the message that these were the same people who inflicted this suffering on the Serbs, on the Christians, and that they could not live together. These are the messages that Brenton Tarrant, Andres Breivik, and the white supremacists across the world are taking as their own messaging in dealing with quote-unquote invaders, Muslims, who they see as a foreign cancerous body in the Christian societies. And that is deeply, deeply troubling. And if that dehumanization is not reversed at the source where it was in fact implemented in Bosnia, then there is no way that such messaging can be delegitimized globally.
Jasmin, is that what you fear too? I mean, Karadzic certainly played on the idea of this clash of civilizations, which seems to have a growing appeal in the darker corners of the world.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I think there's two points to be made. The first is essentially what Refik was just saying, that we have to be cognizant the manner in which Karadzic's Serb ultranationalist project and the project of course, his benefactor Slobodan Milosevic in Serbia, those who initiated these genocidal campaigns of the 1990s, that project remains very much active and alive within the sort of narrative and ideological framework of the global far right. And obviously, it's having catastrophic and horrifying consequences for our friends and colleagues in New Zealand. And of course, as Refik was mentioning, this is not the first time that we have noted this. Not only was it present in the terrorist attacks in Norway a number of years ago, but of course, for those of us who research and spend any time looking at the narratives and the discourses of the global far right, the Serb ultranationalist project of the 1990s has become a major ideological pillar of how they understand the contemporary world. It has arguably sort of entered as in their mainstream, their proverbial mainstream, on par with things like the Holocaust and the crimes of the Nazis, with things like the apartheid regimes in South Africa and Zimbabwe, the American Confederacy, things like that. So it's very much become a meme in the true sense of the word in their worldview. The other aspect that must be acknowledged is that at this very moment, the government, the SNSD government of Milorad Dodik in Bosnia-Herzegovina's RS entity, is at this very moment engaging in an orchestrated and organized campaign of historical revisionism and denialism that features by organizing the so-called commission to reinvestigate the Srebrenica genocide and the broader crimes against humanity that took place in Bosnia-Herzegovina as part of the broader Bosnian genocide. And that commission includes a number of individuals from Europe and from the wider world. So there's a real global phenomenon. There's a real global resonance to what Radovan Karadzic, Slobodan Milosevic, Ratko Mladic, and all their cohort did in the 1990s. And it's crucial that it be recognized as an immediate threat to communities, not just in the Balkans or in Bosnia-Herzegovina, okay, but indeed everywhere where we value multiculturalism and multi-ethnicity.
I don't want to end on a downer. So, Emila, Karadzic's freedom may be gone, but it seems his poisonous project, if you like, is still very much alive. Where do you find hope for optimism?
Karadzic has indeed, and his project, have destroyed so much of Bosnia. We touched upon, of course, the biological destruction, the killing of people, displacement. We haven't mentioned much other forms of this genocide, such as cultural destruction, which, alas, under the UN banner is not to be named as cultural genocide. But nevertheless, it's a form of saying you do not belong here, and I will not just rewrite your future, I am going to rewrite your history. So displacement is more complex. We there is another, of course, yet another element, and that is rape camps, in which the idea of ethnic cleansing through impregnating non-Serb women with Serbian semen is a way of propagating greater Serbian identity and so on and so forth. So the legacy, alas, has been both psychological and real and material. And it does take a lot of post-trauma, of course, effort to deal with things that people feel. I mean, I think yesterday was a highly emotional day, and I think that there was no really catharsis per se. There was simply an acknowledgement this had to be somehow given a seal and then let's move on. But I think what's something that Refik and Jasmin have already alluded to, and that is dehumanization that continues at schools. You mentioned the segregation. We have a situation where children are asked not to walk on the same street and not to have recess at the same time so as not to meet. Therefore, we can easily say it should start at home, but home is not always the place to do, because people have been brainwashed that their identity is somehow glued to other people's identities, people who are of the same religious or ethnic background, and therefore they have to stand up to each other. Those who can do the change are those who will be taught at school that these symbols are no longer valid, that they have no meaning to our world, that the so-called Turkish yoke and Muslims and non-Muslims and the kind of clash of civilization is really has no longer any kind of use to the Balkan region, to any region for that matter.
Okay.
And that,
we'll
in fact, there is a lot in our history that we can draw to.
It is certainly an important moment. It remains to be seen how much of a turning point this will be. Thank you to all our guests, to Jasmin Mujanovic, to Refik Hodzic, and to Emile Butorovic. And thank you for watching. You can see the programme again anytime by visiting our website, aljazeera.com. And for further discussion, just go to our Facebook page. That's facebook.com/AJ Inside Story. And you can also, of course, join the conversation on Twitter. Our handle is @AJ Inside Story. From me, Nick Clark, and the whole team, bye for now.